So I'll introduce Doreen in a second. It's amazing what we can do, right, in this day and age. But before I get to Doreen, I wanted to point to the first line on this poster for her, the J. Carter Brown Memorial Lecture. And J. Carter Brown was this gentleman here. I had the great pleasure of knowing him. And he was obviously a member of the Brown family and for many years the director of the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. And he is also the one who actually lived, and of course in that role, he commissioned I.M. Pei to build the East Wing. So he was director for 25 years, did a lot of blockbuster shows in Washington, D.C., really a major tenure there. And he commissioned I.M. Pei to do the East Wing. And whenever he came to Providence, he would stay in his family home, which is now the John Nicholas Brown Center. His father was, of course, John Nicholas Brown. Some of you have come there, and I have the great privilege of spending a lot of time there right now. And he had a little apartment on the top floor after Brown had, after the family had given it to the university, and he would always stay there. And it was wonderful to work with him on a project which we did before he sadly passed away, much too young, after getting ill with cancer. But he was a really interesting figure, and he was also, together with his father, he took over from his father and be involved in campus planning at Brown. He was very involved there, and actually he commissioned I.M. Pei to design a building for us, which you see here on the right. Pretty cool, actually, and it never got built. It was supposed to be where the Geochem building is now. And then things became too expensive, and we did Geochem, which is nice too, but not quite as good as this, I think. But most importantly, and the reason why I'm talking about him now is we call this lecture series, and we do one or two every year, the J. Carter Brown lecture series, because for many years he was the head of the Pritzker Prize Committee, and for about the first 20 years. And you see some of the winners of the prize. There's Frank Gehry, there's Alejandro Aravena, whom we talked about just 2 days ago. There's Norman Foster and a few others, of course. There's Renzo Piano with a beard. And so there's Richard Meyer and a few others. So he led this committee, and when he passed away, the Pritzker family of Chicago, owners of the Hyatt Hotel chain, they gave us some money to honor J. Carter Brown, this great leader in the field of public humanities, cultural heritage, art education, and museums with a lecture. And today it's really my great honor to introduce Doreen, who is in Kampala. And it's just such a pleasure to see you again. I must say we've known each other for about 15 years, I think, right? And Doreen went to Catholic University, got her Bachelor of Science in Architecture, and then went to Yale. And I think, Doreen, you had just finished at Yale when I started teaching there, and we ran into each other and became friends. And she worked for Robert A.M. Stern, who was the dean at the time at Yale, for Adjaye, David Adjaye. We'll talk a little more, of course, in greater detail. She worked for Ella B. Beckett and Grusin Sampton Architects, and then decided to go back to Uganda and start her own practice. And we'll hear about that in a second. And she is now, she's still a registered architect in the United States, and of course in Uganda, where she has her firm. And she founded Adengo Architecture there in 2015, 7 years ago. And what makes her work so interesting is that it's a really a broad range of scale and approaches, the design of furniture, all the way up to buildings and housing complexes, and a lot of advocacy focusing on the urban and regional context in Kampala. She's an architect, but also an architectural historian, as you'll see in a moment, and very much a public advocate. She has worked on a good number of exhibits and workshops exploring Ugandan urbanism and architecture at the Goethe Institute in Kampala, at the Architecture Museum of the Technical University in Munich. She has taught around the world at the New School, Pratt Institute in New York, at the University of Johannesburg's Graduate School, and she's currently a professor at Uganda Martyrs University. Architect Magazine, not too long ago, called her one of the next progressives. I love that. And quoted her for saying, it's critical to make the case that architects and urban planners can improve people's everyday lives, helping cities develop sustainably. please help me welcome Doreen Adengo.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. Everyone can hear me well?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Very well. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you. I last gave a talk at Brown 2 years ago, and it's an honor to be back again. And I look forward to engaging discussion with the students during this talk. So my lecture is titled Post-Colonial Kampala, because much of our work tells the story of the built environment through the lens of the local user. We explore how buildings are being modified over time to meet the demands of a contemporary city. To give you a little bit of my context, Kampala is the capital city of Uganda. Kampala is originally built on 7 hills, there are many more hills now. It's a very green city, and it's in between these hills are wetlands that filter water before it reaches Lake Victoria. So what we see over here is Lake Victoria. Kampala is growing really fast, very rapidly, at 6.2% per annum. We are now over 3 million people. According to the CAA, that's the Commonwealth Association of Architects, we're about 200 architects in Uganda. According to the AIA, the number of architects in the US is 140,000 architects. So just to compare the number, we're very few architects in Uganda. And the public tends to build without us. And what this shows, this chart, is the blue, which you can't see, is the number of the architects. And then the red is the growth that's going on, which is really fast. Therefore, the public is building without architects. That's leading to poor quality projects, and in some cases, collapsing of buildings. There's few schools of architecture in Uganda, and very few graduate schools as well. So this chart also shows this context. So given this, I decided to build a practice in Kampala, and this is my team. I set up a practice in Kampala in 2016. It's a very diverse team. We're very interested in engaging with skills and knowledge. And we're recently profiled, as Dietrich mentioned, by the Architect magazine, The Next Progressives. This showcased our work, which is very grounded in research. So I'm now going to take a step back, just looking at pre-colonial Uganda. So I'll start with a very brief history of Uganda. So what we see in this image is Kampala, which was originally the kingdom of Uganda. So I should actually make it clear that Uganda is the country, Uganda is the kingdom. So kingdom was a smaller location. I'll explain why the two changed. So in pre-colonial Uganda, the construction materials were sustainable. So as you see in this image here, mostly reeds, thatch, materials that could easily be renewed over a rainy season. The idea of having a temporary building was the norm. For example, each king built a new palace on a different hill. So with this context, this image shows the first Europeans who came to Uganda. This was in 1927. They were in search of the source of River Nile. This sketch shows the king meeting the two explorers for the first time. To give a context of this, this image shows 1827. However, the first Europeans that came to South Africa were Portuguese, who arrived in 1488. So there's a difference between South Africa and Uganda, which is about over 300 years, just to understand the difference. The next image is of that king, King Mutesa. This is believed to be the first photo taken of him at the time, which was 1875. And next to him is an artistic impression of the king. This next image is the next king, King Mwanga, who became king after the death of his father, King Mutesa I. While King Mutesa built his palace in Lubaga Hill, so a different hill, King Mwanga built his palace in Lubya, which is another hill. That's just showing how the king's palace moved. So this king reigned from 1884 to 1898. He was toppled and exiled to Seychelles, by the British Protectorate Administration. This was 1999. To understand how things fell apart, it's important to consider what happened on June 3rd, which was in 1886, a date that is commemorated in Uganda as Uganda Matters Day. So I would encourage students to just look up Uganda Matters Day because it will give the full story. But I'll just make it clear that this is the moment when things fall apart and the Buganda Kingdom ceased to be. And soon after this, it went from being a pre-colonial Buganda to a British protectorate. Who we see here is Frederick Lugard, who became a military administrator for the British Protectorate from 1890 to 1891. He built his fort on top of Kampala Hill, which is now known as Old Kampala. And the image that you see on the right is this fort, Fort Lugard, which was the first permanent building that was built in Kampala. And now I'll talk more about the British Protectorate and how this came to be. So what was specific to Uganda is the British Protectorate was not a settler's colony. According to a book titled Focus on Africa by Richard Upton Light, I'll quote, the government policy in Uganda seemed to have been more in the nature of a controlled experiment. The existing kingdom of the Great Buganda tribe supplied a well-developed political organization on which to build. There was a king or kabaka, a parliament or a lukiko, a system of great chiefs, and this structure was left intact. In other words, the British Protectorate set up an indirect rule. So what we see in this next image is the town planning that happened during this British Protectorate period. So if we look at this image on the left, what we see is Mengo Hill. That's where the King's Palace was, and that remained Old Kampala. And then around in these other hills, so the other seven hills, some planning started to happen. One of the town planning included an extension to Kololo and Naguru by German architect Ernst May in 1847. And these are some of the images. And this next plan was done, it's called the Kendo Plan, by Henry Kendall. This was in 1955. And this shows some forested areas, some open spaces. But within the same Kendall plan was a segregation town planning that was going on. These plans were done under the British Protectorate government and were influenced by consultations with town planning in South Africa. And now we get to 1962, which is when Uganda had independence. And so from this image, we get to see what Kampala looked like at this time. What is important is that this city was being planned for 50,000 people, yes. And this is why it looks this way, very low density, very open spaces, completely different from the first image I showed of what Kampala looks like right now. So I'm now going to go through the architecture of independence and what happened during this time. So in this image, we see a structure that's being set up during the celebrations of independence. It was a period of optimism in which experimentation was done with building technology from Europe and also a lot of large projects. This is the arc, the Independence Arc, that was added as a memorial celebration for Uganda's independence. This was 9th October 1976. This was commissioned by Milton Obote, who became the first Prime Minister of Uganda, and he had just visited Ghana at the time, who had their own independence arc, and that's where he got the idea to then have this independence arc. This image shows a book called Uhuru. This book has photos that were taken by a Ugandan engineer, Wamba, who in the 60s was looking at all the cities that were being built during this time. As I said, a lot of construction was happening. The very celebratory time, a lot of technology. Unfortunately, soon after this, there was a time of political turbulence. And as a result, archives were destroyed and many actors of the building industry left the country, resulting in a knowledge gap. And so I now move on to the architecture of independence and this workshop that I worked on. So I was invited to develop a Kampala chapter for Uganda. So it's the Kampala chapter for African modernism. This is a project that was done by Manuel Hertz, who we see over here. And so I'm going to show you a quick video of this workshop that we did.
Modernism Kampala workshop has been a really great experience. We explored the relationship between architecture and photography. What we chose to do was have a photography student paired with an architecture student and go to look at a selected building and see what comes out of that collaboration.
Putting those two more or less traditionally separate practices, semi-separate sort of disciplines together in a workshop and to make collaborations, I think was really a great way to think about photography.
Before, I used to believe that photography is only about taking pictures. But after meeting my fellow friend today, I realized that photography is much more than that. It's about telling a story about the building. It's about telling a story between the people and the building.
find most people look at these buildings as very recent and, you know, there's nothing special to them, but I think this workshop gives us the opportunity to uncover the hidden stories behind these buildings.
Finally, we've seen several buildings that were fantastic. I've seen the coffee board building with its colorful facade that is so playful and wonderful. We've seen the student housing at the university, which is quite amazing, and several others like the Uganda House in its strict precision, which is really has a very high quality.
The most interesting part of the workshop for me was the conversation that we had with architect Philip Cutting, who is part of an old British firm that did most of the buildings during the independence time. And hearing his story about the decisions behind the materials chosen, the form that was chosen, what was happening at that time. I'm hoping that we can record all this information before it gets lost.
Okay, so this video more or less summarizes our collaboration. This next image is of the exhibition that we had after all the students had done the photography and printed and have this, the exhibition. And then I had these guided tours where people got to have these discussions about buildings. And one of the most provocative questions that came from the audience is, if all the architects were not local, what is African about African modernism? That's a good question. A response to this is that these foreign architects designed for the climatic and topographic conditions. However, they did not consider African culture. It was left to the audience, especially the young architects and the young architecture students, to think for themselves what it means to design a building with an African identity. I've now moved on to another project, which is Mary Stuart Hall. This is the first women's hall in Uganda at Makerere University. This is a project that I've done with the CCA, the Canadian Center for Architecture. And it's called Centering Africa. And this research proposed telling the story of Mary Stuart Hall, the first women's dorm in Uganda, which was built at a time when there was a focus for education for women. And I think what I'll just say in summary is looking at the form, this tall building, you might think, why this brutalist building, why so tall? But if you start to understand what was going on at the time, for one, there's big pressure to have more housing for women. And hence, there was a tower, as opposed to some of the other kinds of structures that were going on. And I worked with the CCA on a research article that was published recently in their website, where we talked in more detail about what happened and this story about building Mary Stuart Hall. And this information, the main goal is to have this information to a wider audience. And I hope that you'll be able to read this article later. Another project is the Uganda Museum. So the image we see here is Uganda Museum. It was designed by Ernst May. This was in 1954, around the time he was doing the urban planning as well. The Uganda Museum won a grant from the Getty Foundation. This is Keeping It Modern initiative. And here's a short video that explains that as well. So now I'm gonna try again to go back to the videos.
I'm very excited to be here. There's been a workshop which has been taking place on the conservation of Keep It Modern project. And this workshop has been very important for us on the way for preparing a guideline, especially for how can we ensure that this building will be sustainable and be useful in future.
It's 63 years since the museum was built, and so I think it's about time that we as professionals, we as museum people, architects, start thinking about what we can do to improve what is there, what was done, and make it better for posterity without necessarily changing the fabric of the building and the thought that went into it. So I'm very happy to be here with all the professionals who are here to talk about that same thing and put our minds together and see what we can come up with for the museum.
This project, after having the conservation management plan, will inform the administration of the museum on the best practice of not only conserving the building, but also the important collections that we hold.
This museum was built at a different time, in a different context, and of course, over time, a lot has changed. And so in thinking about the future of the museum, we need to think about how the city has grown, the users that want to interact with the museum, how they are thinking about things differently. And one thing that we would like to take into consideration is how to make the museum more accessible to the public.
I think it's important that we build appreciation for modern architecture and we work towards preserving the original design intent of the architect. And in order to do that, we must understand the values, underlying values, and the issues, as well as the physical problems of the building. So we're working with the young students and young professionals to look at the values of the building, look at the problems, and try and resolve the issues, but still preserve the authenticity and integrity.
Conservation and heritage issues are a relatively new concept in education. So it is fantastic to draw in students and to go around with them and look at the building and check the building, draw them into the practice of this kind of work.
The tour around the workshop, very informing, and I found various things that had to be corrected, including the roof, and I felt that it was very important for me to discover this.
I'm learning a lot on how to add on to something that's existing, how to deal with something that's already existing, and how to deal with the authenticity and the integrity of monumental buildings. And so far from the tour yesterday around the museum, I realized that so many changes have been made, so many things have been added onto the building, and I feel like there should be more order with how this is done.
The climate has really changed, especially, I think it's throughout the country. So this drastic change is having great impact on the buildings, on the artifacts we have in the museum. And I think with this workshop, we can come up with a conservation management plan and have informed decision making that can help us preserve both the building and the artifacts in the museum.
My role in this project is to advise the project team members on the aspects of objects conservation and preservation, with a special focus on the indoor climate. So we will set up a set of sensors to measure the relative humidity and temperature in order to establish the risks for the collection in the coming time. And from those data, try to establish ways to reduce the risks and to reduce the impact on collections.
I like the approach that the Uganda Museum took to put the workshop together, because there is representation from across the sector. They did come and bring together a lot of stakeholders who would be important to coming up with this conservation plan.
Looking into the future, the museum needs to think of ways to become more interactive with the public, to come up with programs and initiatives that draw people in and allow them to be more part of how the museum is moving forward into the future.
I think that the museum, and it's also something that, you know, has been considered in the past, look at the museum as a cultural center.
Unless you know your past, you will not know the future. If you lose this building, the past is lost. That's why we need a conservation management plan for this building. And this workshop has been about brainstorming, deliberating, and making guidelines for this building to ensure that it survives.
So it's important to understand that this is not a construction project, and instead our aim is to work as a multidisciplinary team to fully understand the unique, what is unique about this building and how to best preserve it. And so what you see here is a network of the different consultants who are working together. The Uganda Museum, as we see in the center, the ministry, with engineers, so, you know, a really big team working together to create the conservation management plan. This is also an image with the photos from that workshop that we had. This will be the first conservation management plan for the modernist building in Uganda. It's my hope that this is only the beginning of a national movement to preserve many of our modernist gems. On that note, I'm now moving to a completely different topic, which is on affordable housing. I'd like to end the talk by showing our projects that are intended for construction, which is very different from the previous projects, which were mainly research projects. So what we see here is a mixed-use building. The client approached us wanting this mixed-use building, and we engaged with them and convinced them to use locally sourced brick. So there's brick that's in Tebe, which is very close to this location. And this material can be used as brick screen wall, the floor finishing, and I'll try to get to this point. And so I think for us, one of the big pluses was to get a kind of client that normally likes aluminium panels as one of the most the materials that they prefer, a lot of imported materials. So to us, to get them to move towards something more sustainable and something more local was a big plus. And this next image is one of the first affordable housing prototypes that we worked on. This was in collaboration with the local university, where we worked with students, and we set up a budget and thinking sustainably and came up with an affordable prototype house. and we're working with the developer. And if we move on to the next slide, we made all these drawings showing different plan layouts and all of this. But as we're working on the drawings, the developer started to think more about the affordability of the entire project. This was a big project. And so looking at the roads, electricity, the water, the sanitation, all the services, what you call sites and services, the developer started to see that this was adding up to about 30 to 50% of the total cost. This would have normally been subsidized by the government. If the government could then subsidize the water, electricity, and all of this. But that's not the case in our context in Uganda. So that meant that the developer had to use his own money for those costs. Then on top of that, we found out that there was 30% tax from the government on top of the sites and services. So at this point, this developer felt that he couldn't move on with the project. And so we ended with this particular project by understanding very fully that when you think of the house alone, which is what we see in this image, it's very important to understand that questions about affordability is not about the house alone. It's about the infrastructure that's needed to support that house. So taking this into account, we were then encountered by another client that also was looking for, they have a large project and were looking at affordable housing. And they also, you know, it's a Uganda dream where everyone wants their house and their land. So they want, basically, if I go back to this, they want their house on their land and that kind of idea. And so we had to convince this client that let's start to think about density, first of all, and also because we now know that there's the 30% tax from the government, and then the sites and services are something that the client has to think about upfront. We do then have to start to do the math and the numbers to make sure that as we're coming up with a project from the beginning, something as large as this, that we're thinking through the costs and sustainability, and also the density, and convincing the next user. So with this, we're looking at the brick as well. And so in this last image, we'd like to convince the end user to think beyond the one house and thinking in density and just the idea of having a community where we're thinking more about sustainability and having affordable housing in a more, in a way that fits the context that we're in. This is an ongoing process. We're now about to start the construction of this project. And it's, time will tell where this goes. So on that note, I'll end here and hand over back to Professor Dietrich for question and answers. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Doreen. That was really fantastic, a great overview too. We had talked about brutalism in this class quite a lot to see examples in Kampala and then moving on to sustainability. Also, of course, I know some people have, some in the audience online are from Dokomomo. Of course, for them, the discovery of these amazing Ernst May buildings that you are helping to preserve for posterity are of great interest, and then get a glimpse of your practice as a young architect who is
starting in practice in Kampala, I thought was all very, very interesting. We have microphones here, and I suspect, as typical Brown students, there are all kinds of questions that you might want to ask. And so let's see if there's a hand for the first question. We can pass on those microphones, unless you sit on the edge and you can come out and speak here. But let's hear if there are any questions.
Hey, Doreen, thanks for joining us. How did studying in the U.S. affect the ideas that you brought back to Uganda and what you're designing nowadays?
That's a good question. How did the U.S. affect? No, I never thought about it, but let's see. I think that I'll tell you what I learned. One of the biggest lessons I learned in the U.S. was about communication and communicating through, it's both drawings and images. And I think that was just one of the parts of my training that helped me a lot, that when I moved back and I understood that I was in a different context, and thinking through how to communicate very challenging situation, like let's see what I'll explain. I think I say with that workshop that we had with the photographers and the architects, having to explain that we're actually looking for a story, and that each student had to then articulate what story they were finding. I think that's one way that I tried to emphasize as we were working with students at the time. So I don't know if that helps, but communication for me became very important in getting across difficult topics. And I found that using visuals helps. I believe that the reason I use videos, like the two videos that I showed, is also one way that I found to get across what is going on, that in a short video, someone can understand clearly what's going on within a context that is not familiar. I don't know if that answers your question.
Thank you. And Abubakar has a question, I think.
Hello, Doreen. Thank you for this great talk. You mentioned at the beginning of your talk that in Uganda, you have architects, but the locals do not patronize the services of architects to set up their structures. I'm from Ghana, and then we have a similar situation. And so I wanted to ask you, what do you think would remedy this?
I think that there has to be almost like an awareness campaign, because the average person in the public actually doesn't know what an architect does. And I've had situations where I'm speaking to someone and the person is basically what they think is that my role is to do the drawings. I hand the drawings over and then that's it. Then they go and build without the architect. And so trying to explain that actually I should be part of the whole process, coming through, you know, for the during the construction and all of this. What each person thinks is that the architect is expensive and that's why they want to get rid of us. So it will take a lot of making the public more aware of our role, because at the moment most are just not aware. So it will take time, and I understand that this is a problem around Africa, and that's why it makes sense that in Ghana it's the same. And I think maybe we all collectively have to find a way to get the message across.
Thank you. I think it's such an interesting slice into a different slice of insight into a different sort of context of how architecture comes about, very much driven, in fact, by the future inhabitants, but often done with sort of minimal means. And I think your interventions there are really fascinating, because these
houses that we saw that you're about to build clearly respond to the climate and work with the client who's aware of what's needed and used local materials very well, and of course also had to face a change of mentality that you have to implement, which I thought was really quite fascinating. So it's a wonderful sort of insight. I wonder if there are any other questions right now. And there is Philip Moiser in the first row, who is the author of a 7-volume publication on African architecture. You might have seen it. So, Philip.
Doreen, I have one question. So you were showcasing these two projects, these multi-story housing units. So and you were also mentioning these urbanization processes in Kampala. So in my understanding, these are the most important housing typologies which need to be built not only in cities like Kampala, but how is the acceptance from the people who should live there? Because this is with these multi-story housing units, you are introducing a new typology into the market. This is not the traditional houses, not the traditional residential houses. And how successful are these typologies in the market?
Oh, that's a good question. So yeah, as I said, most people want a house, a bungalow on the ground. And there's a strong belief that the house should be on the ground. Very different from, let's say, New York, where the most valuable apartment is at the top. In Uganda, the idea is that the most valuable thing is on the ground. It's very different. So it is a challenge, and we're working with this client to just almost sensitize and just bring up awareness, I guess also the way I'll put it, that there is value in having an apartment and that your apartment can be on the second floor. And that's not, you know, basically, the challenge is that the bungalow, it just, as I mentioned earlier in the first typology, that developer was not able to make the project work. So we had to start thinking about density, and that brings this other typology. So, it's really about what is affordable and what is possible. And also the city is growing. So if we look at the images of Kampala, you know, pre-colonial, that was very different. And if you look at Kampala now, it's very dense. So we are moving towards density. It's just what is the more responsible way to densify. And raise awareness of the importance of having density versus that other housing that doesn't really work out.
Thank you. That makes a lot of sense. So the advocacy of changing these patterns is part of your job as an architect, quite different from here where you have, you know, very clear expectation of how people want to live and you respond to them. In Kampala, you have to really develop the mentality of the client. So fascinating, very, very interesting. I think if I don't see any other hands up, I would say it's probably around 9 o'clock in Kampala, right?
Yes.
Something like that. So this was a really terrific lecture and a wonderful conversation. I think I'll let you go. And I wonder if our technicians could show the audience once again and we can applaud and wave to Doreen and thank her for coming. Thank you so much, Doreen. Bye, thank you.
Bye.
Bye.